Good evening, baseball fans. It is Sunday, September 29th, I think, because I don't have my glasses and that's very little print. I believe it's the 29th. If it's the 28th, so sue me. Anyhow, this is the full crew for Bourbon and Baseball. I'm Suzy. That's Tom. That's Kelsey. I hope I'm pointing the right way. If I'm not, you can obviously tell who's who. And we're going to get into the breakdown of all of the baseballs. All of the baseballs. Guys, it's I was going to say game 162. Technically, it's game 161 because we didn't play. But Kelsey, you had a game 162. How was yours?
It was fine. It happened. The Cardinals won, at least. Very meaningful baseball against two powerhouse teams. No, that it was not.
You ended on a high note. The kids got to play, right?
Yeah. I guess that's something you're not to ask for at this point.
You're not shipping away DFAing people for at-bats before they reach a bonus level. Is there accomplishments? I'm just saying. Before we get into a little bit longer, we are going to give you the rated R warning, though, because it is a rated R podcast for all of the cuss words, probably some inappropriate adult humor, but definitely the cuss words, because some of it happy cussing, some of it not so happy cussing. But just know that there will be the four-letter words, so if you yourself are uncomfortable with those, probably skedaddle on out of here. Go find a less fun podcast. If you're cool with that, stick around. We're a good time. So how do you guys think the postseason schedule / teams lined up with how you guys thought they were going to be at the beginning? Any surprises? Any disappointments?
Tigers. We got to give the Tigers a shout out, right? Because I think they surprised us all even from a couple weeks ago. Not We were hot on the Tigers sneaky train since before even game one. But I don't
Royals think, as well.
Yes, yes. I think what we didn't predict was the Twins crashing and burning as hard as they did. But I still can't say I'm like terribly surprised. I do think overall the Tigers were probably a better built team, certainly a healthier team overall to try to make a run here. I'm glad with the way that shook out. How do you guys feel about playing the Tigers rather than the Twins, since the Astros are going to play the Tigers?
It was going to be the Royals, which I was much more prepared to just steamroll. But who isn't fine with facing the probable AL Cy Young winner, Tarik Skubal? I'm totally fine with that. Triple Crown winner. I'm not scared at all. There's no fear in these eyes in the least bit.
Who doesn't want to face their former manager that they enjoyed so much success with coming back into a building where he clearly has a very good understanding of the ball club, of how to manage a team under that kind of atmosphere? Who doesn't love that? I can't wait.
Listen, AJ Hinch, you managed that game like you managed the other game where you didn't put in Gerrit Cole. That's fine. You do that. Do that. Lose that game. We're fine with that. Totally okay.
I'm bummed to see that, I guess we'll stick with the AL here, that the Royals and the Orioles are matching up, though, because I think those are two teams that kind of have similar vibes in ways, and I would like to see both of them move on to the DS. I think the Orioles have an obvious advantage here. Is that how we're feeling overall?
Honestly, I don't even know if they do or not. I want to say yes, because on paper, clear advantage on paper. But the way that they've been playing, and honestly, the way that the Royals have been playing since Vinny Pasquantino went down, not a great look. But now that Vinny Pasquantino may be coming back, getting that back in the lineup will probably help. But I don't know. Ellie, you going to do anything? Are the young guys that they called up going to do anything for them? You got Tony Daters over there trying as hard as he can to bring him along. You got Gunner in there trying to do the things, but I don't know. And when I heard that Grayson was going to go down, I was like, oh, that's not a great look either. If we're talking about starting rotations, I feel like the Royals have got the edge up there.
Do you forget that the Baltimore Royals have this guy named Corbin Burns? He's really good. He's like
one game
player winner.
One game. He can't pitch all the games.
And then they're playing in Baltimore. You got the bird bath going on. Y'all know firsthand what that ballpark's. So yes, do I think Kansas City's a good team? Good young team. Great young story. They lost 116 games last year. They're on the rise. They're on the come up. Bobby Wood Jr. is a stud. He's going to be an MVP in this league at some point. It would have been this year if not for Aaron Judge. So, yes, Kansas City will be good eventually. Do I think they're ready to be that team now? Absolutely not. I think Baltimore has plenty to be able to get through that. And if it was a 7-game series, maybe I'd think differently. I'd agree with you. They would need more arms. But to just have to win two and you've got your rotation lined up the way you want to be able to start Corbin game one, I feel like Baltimore shouldn't have a problem with Kansas City.
So who's their two and three?
That's a good question. I don't have that answer, but I just feel like with their offense,
That's above our pay grade, Susie.
I just feel like with their offense, are they really going to need two great starts by two great starting pitchers?
No.
Yeah, though.
Kansas City's not going to, I don't think Kansas City's going to go into Baltimore and just all of a sudden tear the cover off the ball.
Depends on what Tommy Pham is having for breakfast. I don't know. I do think there are some guys. I think Kansas City could be the Diamondbacks of last season, and Tommy Pham in true form will be with them like he was with the Diamondbacks last season. So I do think that the potential is there if everything clicks and if the baseball gods are on their side, for sure. The biggest thing is that anything can happen in a three-game series, right? So on the other side, we are still waiting to see who is going to play the Padres and the Brewers. The Snakes are still alive. They live.
But the Snakes need so much help.
They're not in charge of their own destiny. The Snakes have done all they can do. The Diamondbacks won today. The Mets also won today. But the Braves lost. So the Braves and the Mets are going to have to play tomorrow, Monday, September 30th. They have a doubleheader. And either way, they're going to have to play both games. Do you guys think there's any chance that... So the only way that the Diamondbacks get in is if one of those two teams loses both games. Is there any chance that happens?
100%. And I'll tell you why. Those two teams absolutely 1,000% hate each other.
Yeah.
Nothing will give one more pleasure than ending the other season.
Yeah.
So whoever wins that first game, I guarantee you, while they may not get their best starter up behind them, they're going to go out there and try to inflict damage and knock somebody out of the postseason. I don't think they're just going to be like, okay, you win one, we won, we won one, we both win. I don't think that either one of them wants to see them in the postseason.
Absolutely. Can come back to bite you if you do go into it with that mentality. I also just think these guys are too competitive to fully take that approach. I had a lot of people tweeting at me today that, oh, it's in the Padres' best interest for the Diamondbacks to win today, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yeah, but I don't think they're just going to give it to them. Yeah, I don't see it being that kind of toss-up, but all eyes are going to be on the Mets and the Braves tomorrow. The Phillies and the
all I'm saying, White Sox, what are we doing here? All of a sudden your bats want to come alive and you score 9 runs? What's happening?
They're like, you know what? We just want to fuck the Astros. I really wanted them to go on a winning streak so that they like stopped at 120. They did lose that ultimate 121st game, but I really wanted them to have this narrative going into next year that they were just never going to lose again. I was hoping for that for them.
Look, the White Sox.
I don't think it's going to happen.
And the Tigers are divisional foes. So they were trying to play spoiler as much as they could. They pushed Garrett Crochet's start back. They did everything they could to try to stop the Tigers from making the postseason. So I'm not mad at the White Sox for playing, you know, hard now. It would have been good if they had played that way the whole season, but bad teams are bad teams for a reason. I don't have any fault with the White Sox, you know.
All of a sudden, the Tigers forgot how to hit? Like, what? Why? What is happening here?
I was like, okay.
They went up to the street.
I see. They are.
I just want to see how you feel about this while we're talking about teams that are not in contention. I just saw that Blake Snell actually declined to make his last start of the season. He should have started today against the Cardinals because it was not a team fighting for a playoff spot. So he said, quote, this game has no meaning. But he said if he had a chance to ruin someone's playoff hopes, he would have done it. What is your take on that?
I'm his mixed team, and I know he's already, or if I'm a team looking at him as a potential free agent, and I know he's already came out and publicly said, I'm prepared to tell you no if I don't like it, if there's not like a reason. There's probably going to be teams that are like, nah, we're not touching that guy, which is not smart for him.
On one hand, I understand, like, why throw the bullets? Throw the bullets? Why use the bullets? If you don't need to, and Blake Snell has been Blake Snell on, off, injury-wise, innings-wise, all of that fun stuff. So a part of me gets it, but the other part of me saying, because of that the game had no meaning, no, I don't like that. I don't know. Maybe it comes out in the offseason that there was aches and pains and something that was nagging at him, and that he could have used that as an excuse, and we all would have been like, oh, of course, that makes sense. But the fact that he's like, nah, this game doesn't have any meaning towards any postseason
anything.
Nah, I'm good. Fuck out of here with that.
I agree. The optics are not great.
On, I guess along that same vein, did you guys hear about Kenley Jansen packing up and not even ending the season with the team?
Oh, no.
Yeah. So apparently he had a sore shoulder as it was, so he wasn't going to pitch again after, I want to say, the last homestand. And then after that, he just peaced out, cleaned out the locker, and went home. And then it came out afterwards that apparently he had been aloof in the clubhouse, that he didn't know teammates' names. And I don't know. I get that you're not going to finish this season. You're not going to pitch again. But there's a ton of guys on that roster that's on the IL that are still there, still, I don't know, on the bench, cheering on their team. What are we doing, Kenley? I don't know. I shouldn't be surprised, though, since he went on foul territory and was like, I love the Dodgers. I was really disappointed that the Dodgers didn't re-sign me. I want to end my career on the Dodgers.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess we shouldn't be surprised. But I feel like a lot of people are surprised. Thoughts?
I think it's horrible. If you're a player, and especially if you're towards the back end of your career, and then you want to have this whole Madonna thing where it's, I'm only going to do what I want to do when I want to do it. Teams are going to be really quick to just be like, you can do it at the house. I don't need you on the ball club. I need guys that are going to set a good positive example for all my other guys. And you deciding, you know what? Bum shoulder. I don't want to do anymore. We're done. What am I doing here? What's the point? It's a really bad message to send to other guys. It's a really bad vibes thing for the clubhouse because we are about vibes here.
We got Tom on the vibes. I know. I'm so glad that you're now on the vibes train, Tom. That's it. Only took all season, but we're there.
I reeled both of y'all in. I know if I tailored that just, I was like, ooh. So for me, guys like that, Snell, Jansen, they're going to be out of league really quick talking like that. They're both on the wrong side of 30.
Exactly. The way that you said that, I think that is a really key point with guys like that. And with how quickly the regression comes for these guys, the nature of this work, man, yeah, I just wouldn't be taking that kind of attitude. Surely they've both made enough money that they can leave some of it on the table, but most of them are not willing to do that. Yeah, I like to think that those kinds of things matter. And it's just a bad look, and it's a bummer because it makes all of us think differently about them, at least the kind of fans that we are here.
Absolutely.
Prioritize the vibes. But I guess speaking of, the Dodgers and the Phillies have the bye in the National League, right? Which of those two teams, I guess they're not going to play each other until potentially the NLCS. Which one of those two teams would you be like more threatened by if, say, the Astros are going to face one of them in the World Series?
Personally, you know how I feel about the Dodgers. Inevitably, I want a rematch. Phillies. I want to see Philly. Not saying that I don't want to see the Dodgers because I think the Dodgers are going to beat us. I feel like Philly would be a much more fun World Series for me, personally.
Fuck that. I don't want fun. I want to win. I want the Dodgers. Their rotation is ruins. Kike Hernandez just took a baseball to the spine. Like, they're literally held together with duct tape and bubble gum and paper clips. And I feel if you pitch around Mookie Betts and Shohei Ohtani, you beat that team.
And Tommy Edman.
I was like, do not sleep on Tommy Edman. She will shank you. She will come for you.
Look, I say that
one. If I got to pick one, I probably go at Edman before those two. But it's not a slight at Tommy Edman.
Okay. He's hitting home runs now. That's home run hitter, Tommy Edman, that you're talking about, okay?
If I got to pick one of the three, I'd rather not Jack with Mookie or Ohtani right now. But yes, I respect what Tommy Edman does.
He was known as Tommy Two Bags. He's now known as Tommy Two Jacks because they're calling him Tommy Tanks in LA.
There can only be one Tommy Tanks, and it's unfortunately not Tommy Edman. It is the other Tommy from LSU. Like, it's Tommy White. Come on now, people.
So Philly is just a whole ass wagon. Wheeler at the front of that thing. Their bullpen, they addressed it in the trade deadline. The lineup is the lineup. Philly looks to me out of the NL head and shoulders better than the rest of that league.
Yeah.
And only Philly will beat Philly. If they're right, I don't see a team that can really deal with that.
I completely agree. I think the Phillies from day one of the season have been the team to beat, and they are the team you don't want to see, you don't want to face in this postseason. But on the other side, we've got the Yankees and the Guardians that got the bye. Which of those two teams are you more? The Astros are going to have to face the Guardians, but then they could end up facing the Yankees, if they got to the both got to the CS, which of those two teams do you think are going to make a deeper run here?
Unfortunately, I think it's going to be the Yankees, but we all know who the Yankees daddy is. So just that's neither here nor there. He's 5'6", tiny little goat. It's just facts at this point. It's just facts. I'll be really honest with y'all. I went into this ending Guardian series a little bit more apprehensive. I realized that it didn't really have any sort of bearing on our record, had a little bit more meaning for the Guardians. But the fact that we just went in with literally our B team and just did, I was like, how, Ben Lively, this is not you, Ben Lively, what's happening right now? And I guess I was less than impressed with the Guardians team that showed up to play us for this series versus the Guardians I had seen literally the entire season. And I don't know if that's just me or if I just had, I don't know, the Guardians up on a higher pedestal than they deserved, which I didn't think so because, like, I've seen them play, but I was quite confuzzled.
So, look, we talked about the Tigers and we talked about the Royals as teams, flowers for being here and this and that, but I don't think anybody's doing enough when it comes to the Guardians. When the season started, the Cleveland Guardians were not on anybody's radar as a team that you had to, hey, this is a lookout. They're poised to be one of the top two teams in the American League. Nobody's saying that. And every time you thought they would fall off a cliff, just found a way to get it done and kept moving and clinched that two seed relatively early and really pushed the Yankees for the one seed all the way up until that series. But I say all that to say I feel like they're playing over their skis. I think, like, playoff time, I think that team doesn't necessarily have all the weapons to be able to deal with an Astros, with a Yankees, even with Baltimore, if Baltimore's going good. Great story, phenomenal job done there. I think I'm older than their head coach, which is wild to say, but here they are.
Yeah, the crazy Stephen Bolt was playing in the major leagues last year and managing a team in the postseason. I wonder if that's ever happened before. That's wild, but very happy for him. I think what he's been able to do with them is extremely impressive, probably the AL manager of the year. And the thing about them that I think could keep them in it longer than anyone expects is what's kept them where they're at this whole season, and that is that they find different ways to win. They're not just a one-trick pony. They're a creatively built enough team that that may be what continues to, that, like, if they can continue to get away with that, it could work in their favor. Which, what, like, matchup do you really want to see? Is there two teams that you're like, whether it be in the World Series or the CS, one of the CSs, is there two teams that you're like, I want to see these two teams face off?
Baltimore, New York.
Yeah.
They hate each other. They absolutely hate each other. Bitter division rivals. And I think nothing would give me more joy than watching the Yankees self-destruct under the young Baltimore team, who's not going anywhere. So if you really want to make that Yankee fan base and team just absolutely demoralized, nothing feels right more to me than to watch Baltimore gentlemen sweep or something nasty like that, where they just run them over. And it's, we were never in it. Our ace got smoked. Our rotation is just, or guys behind him, and you pitch around Judge and Soto, and they just don't have a lot of offensive weapons. So Baltimore thoroughly dismantling the Yankees would absolutely feed families, as the kids say.
Oh, that's true. That is true. I really like that. Honestly, though, I would, as a homer perspective, I would love if it ended up being an Astros-Padres World Series. I think that would be fucking electric and break my heart because I secretly also love the Padres.
Secretly, not so secretly. Yeah.
Suzy, you do want the Astros to win the World Series, right? You literally outlined all the really good teams. You're like, I want to see the Astros play them. And I'm like, man, that's not the path of least resistance.
Okay, but you know what, though? What do they say? To be the best, you got to beat the best, right? Granted, I would have loved to see the Royals right now and avoid Tarik Skubal. That's fine. But we beat the Phillies. We were the better team then. Honestly, I think we're still the better team against the Phillies. But the Padres, I don't know. That's the thing. I don't actually know. Anyway, yeah. But I would love to see the Padres because I think the Padres are electric. And again, if you want to beat the best, or if you want to be the best, you got to beat the best. There we go. Enunciation is key.
I do think besides my, you know, innate love for Tommy Edman, I do think I would like to see the Padres knock the Dodgers out again. But I think I want to see the Orioles knock the Yankees out even more. So those are definitely like those matchups to watch in the early rounds here. If there was going to be one team that we maybe, because obviously we haven't talked about the Mets or the Braves or really the Diamondbacks at all yet, because we don't know which of the two are going to be in for sure. So though them along with maybe like the Royals, the Tigers, even the Guardians, the Brewers, really, which teams that maybe people aren't so high on do you, is there a team that we're not expecting as much out of that you think if it's going to be a surprise, who's going to be the surprise team?
Brewers.
I wouldn't for us to say that because it hurts your...
I know. I'm sorry, Delph.
It hurts because it's interdivision, but I love Pat Murphy. I think it's really cool that, like, he's only managing because Craig Counsell decided to go to the Chicago Cubs, and this is what he did with that team. I think they have a lot of really great players, and the fact that everything is clicked for them and they're where they're at is amazing.
They traded Corbin Burns. Devin Williams was out for a quarter of the season.
That missed so many pieces, technically.
Yeah. Christian Yelich, he was there for, what, half a season?
A little more than half, yeah.
Okay, a little more. But the fact that if you asked random non-Brewers fans to name the outfield besides Jackson Churio for the Brewers,
yeah,
you would lose money.
Don't name him.
Most people aren't even naming him, yeah.
I don't know what David do.
I feel like people would know, like, the Jacksons. Jackson Merrill, Jackson Churio, Jackson Holiday. But if I were to tell you, hey, is Sal Frelick a real baseball player? And if he is, what position would he play? I'll give you $20 if you can tell me. To a random baseball fan, they'd be like, I don't, what are you saying right now? Is that a name? No. Like, it's those type of people there. You're like, there's William Contreras and Willie Adames on the Brewers. And who else? Exactly. People that aren't in it are like, I don't, who plays second base for them? Who plays first base for them? Maybe Rhys Hoskins fans would cross over from the Phillies. But I don't think if I asked you who their second baseman is, you'd be like, oh, Bryce Turang. No one's naming Bryce Turang.
They're one of those teams that has never won a World Series, too. So that would be a cool story. I think the Padres winning is a cool story, especially because so much of the makeup of their team is still from their late owner, Peter Seidler, and his vision for them. So I think that is a cool part of their story. Those are some of the emotional strings that would be pulled with those teams. But who do you think is out of the Mets, the Braves, the Diamondbacks, just because of the likelihood of the split tomorrow?
I think so. Atlanta is throwing Chris Sale and Schwellenbach.
Mm-hmm.
What is his first name? Why can't I remember? Because my brain is filled with Brewers Steve. Names. That's why. Spencer Schwellenbach. There we go.
That's right.
But so the fact that you're going up against Chris Sale and Spencer Schwellenbach, like in those two, and they're matching up with, I want to say, what, Severino and Manaea? Or is it McGill?
McGill. It's McGill.
Oh, it's McGill. It's McGill versus Chris Sale.
No, supposedly the rumor was, and I was watching baseball tonight just before we hopped on, is that they're going to start with McGill, and then if they need to go to Severino, they'll go to him. But the likelihood is whoever wins the game, the first game, that second starter won't pitch. It'll be Severino for the Mets or Sale for the Braves. They'll just be like, no, we'll keep him for the series, the wildcard series. But I'll be honest with you. I really feel like one of those teams, I don't know which one, my money's on Atlanta because they're at home. I really feel like one of those teams is going to sweep just because it's so incredibly bitter between those two. And
yeah.
I just feel like this sticks the knife in and twists. Whoever knocks one of them, if they were to knock each other out of the playoffs.
I'm trying to think, because I watched the last couple of innings between the Royals and the Braves today, and they used a good amount of their bullpen today. Yeah. I don't think they didn't use Raisel Iglesias, but they used a fair amount of their high leverage guys today. So I'm all,
man, they
what's
had
what's happening tomorrow?
And they did not make it happen. So
I yeah, but also,
but they've got John Brebbia. They didn't use John Brebbia today. So
that is one of the names that I, yeah.
But John also, the Mets used Diaz in a 5-0 game. So
really?
Yes.
For how many?
It was the
did they just
out. It was like 20 pitches, I believe. Let me double check. Yeah, I was watching that on the baseball tonight, and they were like, man, I don't understand this. And then I want to say it was Buster who was like, well, you got to get there. And I'm like, yeah, you were already going to be there regardless.
Did they throw Maton? Because I want to say that they don't trust I don't think they trust a whole bunch of high leverage guys. I want to say they trust Maton. I think they trust Stanek, but they definitely don't trust Adam Ottavino.
Yeah, it was Maton. Yeah, okay.
Okay. So who is Reed? Reed Garrett? Did they throw Reed Garrett?
No, it was just Peterson, the starter, and then Maton and Diaz each threw an inning.
Interesting. Yeah, maybe they, I don't know. I get, well, like you said, like they had to win this game, though.
Yeah, so 20 pitches for Edwin Diaz. That's
exactly. Really, so if they need him for the first game and they, or they want to go to him at a tie ball game, like maybe you don't do that. That probably doesn't make any sense. But then you definitely don't use him in the second game. But I guess the thought is that you go to Edwin Diaz in the first game, you're going to win that, and that you wouldn't need him for the second.
Let's hope that it shakes out that way for him. I don't know. But the Mets have been a great story, too, though.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I agree. Part of me is like, why do I want the Mets to be in the playoffs? I didn't. I'm confused.
So that we can hear Candelita. Okay. I need to hear OMG.
That's really what I want it for. I also am a big Harrison Bader fan. Jose Quintana. There are guys. And the Jose Iglesias story in itself, like, I want to see that play out even more. I guess that would be a fun conversation. Any, like, unlikely heroes, people that you really think are going to, likely or unlikely, for any of the teams, who are going to be our postseason breakout stars?
So this is going to be really funny because I guarantee you I'm generating a response from Kelsey. They're going to label Tommy Edman as an unlikely hero, and that's going to drive her insane. It's like, oh, no.
Well, no, but he totally, yes, you're right. No, he has that written all over him, and I have predicted it since before he was born, basically, that he was going to be an unlikely postseason hero. Yes, you're completely right, but I know the narrative that has been written, and I'm fully bought in, and whatever gives him more attention at this point, I'm here for it.
You know who I think maybe an unlikely postseason hero? Jesse Winker. Oh. The Mets.
I see it. I can see it. I'm not going to say I love it, but I can see it.
Not going to lie, my opinion of him has changed from earlier this season. Like, even when he was yelling at elderly folk from in the stands, that the Nationals Jesse Winker and the Mets Jesse Winker, I feel like, are two very different people. And I don't know, maybe when one is having fun doing the job that they signed up to do, they're a nicer person. I'm just saying.
If I've got to pick an unlikely hero from the Mets, it's going to be Nimmo. And everybody's going to be like, Nimmo sucks. And then he'll make a play.
I'm going to say one, and I don't want to, but I got to give him the flowers, because my opinion of this player also has changed drastically from the beginning of the season. And it really kind of hurts me, especially because of the team that he's on. So you know that I actually feel this way if I'm giving this team its love, okay?
Yep.
Josh Chisholm, come the fuck down, because how he has, he's almost made the Yankees likable. Between him and Luke Weaver, I find myself being like, and then I remember and I'm like, no, I can't, nope, no thank you. But Josh Chisholm being like, I've never played third base in my entire life, but I will play there. You put me anywhere, I'm there, yes. And the fact that I was very hesitant and very reticent to say that Jazz Chisholm should be on the Yankees, because the Jazz Chisholm on the Yankees, that doesn't fit. And it's made he's fit, and he's made the Yankees more likable. And Luke Weaver. Luke Weaver, what are we doing? I can't like the Yankees, but every time I see a Luke Weaver interview, he's making me like the Yankees just a little bit more. And it tastes like soap coming out of my mouth. I just need you to know that.
If I got to pick a Yankee, it's probably Volpe. I feel like he's just young enough to be like an unsung hero. I think he's going to be a really good player. I can't say Chaz or Jazz because he's not bad. He's never been bad. He was just on bad teams.
It was his personality / attitude / aura. I did not like him. He wasn't my favorite. And when that whole poll came out of the most overrated player and Jazz Chisholm was named, I was like, oh yeah, absolutely, that fits. And he went over to the Yankees and he's totally changed my mind. And I want to say the turning point was the Little League World Series. I was not aware that Jazz Chisholm was such a likable guy. And that's on me. That's on me. Hands up. I'm sorry, Jazz Chisholm. that unknown podcaster that you will probably never hear this. I'm very sorry.
So I gave you an unsung that will drive Kelsey insane. I have one that will drive Suzy insane because we do these things. So I know how she feels. Big John Singleton will be an unsung hero. And Suzy will just be like, we've known about John. I've been begging for John to play. John Singleton is my first baseman. So yeah,
that I love that.
Absolutely. 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 And if anybody from the Astros, any Astros Twitter wants to say that Jake Meyers is going to be an unsung hero, please, I beg Jake Meyers to be an unsung hero. I would love that so much. Anyhow, so who else, Tom?
I'm looking
my dog
for
would
some,
also like to.
I'm looking for some Colton Cowser. I'm looking for the milkman to deliver this postseason. I don't think that's necessarily unpredictable, but I got a good feeling about it.
Another one that I would be, that would just, he wouldn't be like unsung because everybody knows, but if Jackson Merrill does what he's been doing on that roster, he's not supposed to be able to do this young this fast. So I think
what are you talking about? A shortstop never playing center field ever in his entire life, just being a lifelong shortstop, just going over center field and then making it look like he's played center field all his life. That's easy, right? That's
all
super
his
easy.
Life.
What are
he's
you
like
about?
21.
Yeah. Very little liked. In double A, single A? He came up as a shortstop. But that is the team that they just said, we're just going to, all of the shortstops, if you were a shortstop, you can play anything else. And I guess they proved it because legitimately, except for the actual shortstop, Xander Bogaerts, that they was like, JK, Xander, you got to go play second. But now we want you back at short.
You know who else seamlessly transitioned from shortstop to center field? This guy named Tommy Edman that now plays for the Dodgers. So the up the middle transition is something that I think the teams are catching on to a little bit more. And I really think Tommy Edman was a pioneer of that. But yeah, I'm trying to think of a guy on the Phillies that could be like an unpredictable hero other than Edmundo Sosa. But I think Phillies fans would like not be surprised by that at this point. The Phillies are just full of any one of those guys. And probably every one of those guys will contribute in one way or another, which is why I think they're the team to beat. But how about Stephen Kwan? I want him to be like so annoying, he just won't go away. That's what I want from
him. He is so annoying. He's so annoying. He's very annoying.
He's very good.
So annoying. He is. And Jose Ramirez single-handedly beat us and literally scored all of the runs.
Such a bummer that the game was canceled, so he didn't have a chance to get to 40-40. He ends the season one home run short of a 40-40 season, which is just maddening. I'm sure we all care about it as fans more than he probably does, but would have been a really cool thing to add to his resume.
And it would have been literally the quietest 40-40 season ever. Nobody. Yeah. Nobody talked about it. And rightfully, like, Shohei, yes, you get all your flowers. But I don't know. When you see Shohei, and if I just randomly told you, hey, Shohei Ohtani steals bases, hits stingers, and looking at him, you'd be like, okay, yeah, that tracks. But then you look at Jose Ramirez and you're all, I'm sorry, but Jose Ramirez steals bases and hits stingers? Are you sure? And you're like, trust me. Because that's not a body type that I would imagine could do any of those things at all. And that's no hate to J-Ram. Guardians fans are going to roast me and be like, oh my God, Suzy. But no, I love J-Ram. Like,
that is the general consensus from the media and fans, I think, across baseball of why he is underrated in general. But you bring up a good point that we're going to see Shohei Ohtani in the postseason for the first time. And I think I got sick, a little sick of, and I'm a huge Shohei Ohtani gal, don't get me wrong, but I did get a little sick. I felt like that was like, you turn on the Dodgers broadcast and it's just, they're not even talking about what anyone else on that team is doing. They're just talking about Shohei Ohtani. Now, obviously it's incredible. It's historic. It's something that we're going to be talking about forever. He might very well be the best player to ever play the game. We are, witnessing history every single plate appearance that we see with him. He's going to play in the postseason for the first time. Is he going to keep it up?
I don't see why not.
Yeah.
I feel like they have to pitch to him more now. I think, like, Shohei Ohtani is the type of dude the World Baseball Classic made me feel like he absolutely ratchets up another gear when there's a little bit more on the line. We actually, as Astros fans, we're actually incredibly blessed that the Angels just were never really good. Otherwise, you'd have had to deal with Shohei Ohtani a whole lot more in the postseason, and they just never got there. I can't imagine Shohei showing up in his first opportunity to really put it on the biggest stage and just falling flat.
Yeah. A
sick so we don't have to worry about him like turning into Aaron Judge, is what you're saying?
No, I.
Judge's catching strays out here. Look at Suzy.
No, I agree with you, Tom. And I think that's the thing I started my thought of saying. I was sick of getting sick of hearing about him. But as soon as they showed all the celebration pictures and him taking the selfie with his dog and everything, I was like, Shohei Ohtani, this is his first postseason. Like, how freaking cool and how important it is for baseball that this is actually happening. And so I am really excited to see him in the postseason.
I don't know. A part of me was not hoping, because that sounds bad, and really not expecting. But a part of me was thinking that maybe since he hadn't been in the postseason, the lights would be too bright. But then I just go back to thinking about World Baseball Classic Shohei Ohtani, and then he just laughs at me, right? He's like, that's cute, Suzy. I'm just going to be over here with my dog Decoy, and I'm going to just steal bags and hit dingers. And there's enough. You're going to make me say nice things about the Dodgers too, damn it. There's enough guys on that roster that have been in the postseason that have played in those games on this team, on other teams, that I think, unfortunately, I think they'll be okay. Damn it.
I don't. And I really feel like the Freddie Freeman injury is going to be huge, because I really thought that three-headed monster of him, Mookie, and Shohei was just a lot to deal with. And then the other guys would fill in. Now, I really feel like you can navigate that lineup so much easier now that you don't really have to worry about Freddie Freeman being in the middle of it. And I still think they're going to score runs. Don't make it sound like they're just going to get shut out.
Max Muncy has come back and done things. Gavin Lux has... Damn it. Why'd you make me say the nice things? Max Muncy has come back and done things. Hell, even their outfield. Andy Pajes, all of a sudden, just like resurgence of being able to get on base and hit. And then Teoscar Hernandez, you're very sad that Teoscar Hernandez is not an Astro. So it's one of those where literally anyone in that lineup can even things up. Hell, Kike Hernandez got, you know, glasses and was all, hey, look at that. I can see the ball better. And he's been hit ball too. So I guess if we're going to pinpoint anybody, like Miguel Rojas can just hit into another triple play and we all just cheer. I don't know.
I think they're going to be gone. I really feel like there's some holes there that weren't there earlier in the season. And you just don't take a guy like Freddie Freeman out of the lineup and replace him. So
yeah, that's true.
Especially in the postseason where the best pitching is now. They're not beating up on somebody's fifth starter. You're never seeing them.
That's true. It's what, Jack Flaherty and then Yamamoto? Is there two? And then who's their three now? Like that starting rotation is not happy.
Exactly. No, and I also don't think that the Dodgers did what they did this offseason to go all in on a World Series this year. Not that I'm saying they're cool with just like getting kicked out early. I don't think it's like they went all in and it's now or never for them. So yeah, they're going to scrape and claw for sure and do the best that they can. But especially from the four top seeds, like the Phillies, the Dodgers, the Guardians, and the Yankees, I think the Dodgers are maybe the most likely of those four to not get to the CS for me.
Did you say the Dodgers are most likely not to get to the CS? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
That is what. So I think the Yankees, the Guardians, and the Phillies would all make it to the championship series before the Dodgers, personally.
Okay.
Obviously, it depends on who they have to play.
Right. All right. I could see it, though. Let me build off of that, because you said a phrase and it dinged into my ADHD brain. When you said it was now or never this season to win a World Series, is it now or never to win a World Series with Juan Soto and the Yankees?
That's going to be the whole talk of this offseason, isn't it? I don't know. For me, I'm just like, I don't think this is the Yankees' year. I still think they have too many holes, and I just don't want to see it.
I don't know why.
Why I have said, because last year I didn't feel this way about the Yankees. I feel a certain way about them again right now.
It's because you've been hanging out with me too much, Kelsey. I'm very sorry.
Probably is.
I would say it's because she moved closer to them. The proximity's less. So she's running into more Yankee fans.
Totally could be. I think it's the whole let's go out and spend money and make some big flashy moves, but not actually do the structurally sound things. Like I get really annoyed with it. It's the same reason I could not root for the Padres and the Mets last year. But this year I'm like, oh, you had to bring some strategy in with your money. Oh, and look, that action won the things. So yeah, I don't think the Yankees have had to do the work to like be more strategically sound, but they obviously always have enough money to be competitive and to be in the playoff conversation. So I don't know. I just would be like, I would probably be the least happy to see them of any of these teams win a World Series. Would you? You guys would probably say the same, right? Because you're Astros fans.
Yeah, I would say because I am a baseball fan. And when I see a Yankee fan, they act like they invented the damn sport. They own it. We lease it from them. And they can choose winner. We can't be fans. It's so infuriating from that standpoint. I get it. You got all the rings that your team won before you were alive that you never saw. I understand. However, I like seeing them struggle. I like seeing them have to eat the crow. And nothing would give me more joy than Juan Soto taking them, because he's probably going to play well. He plays so well when the lights are bright. And he does all these things to try to get the Yankees to where they need to go. They come up short. And he's, you know what? There's a shiny penny right up the street. And there's an owner that wants to pay me all this money. And they have the vibes. And he bolts. And then the Yankees fans and everyone are just furious. So much just negative energy. And I would love that.
Okay, that's hysterical. I guess obviously you guys want the Astros to win the World Series. If you had to pick another team, because I'll pick one too, because I would want the Phillies. The Phillies are my postseason allegiance. Even if the Snakes get in, I'm in on the Phillies, especially because I might, fingers crossed, get to go to a DS or a CS game. But I'll pick another one too. So if a team other than the Astros is going to win the World Series out of these teams, who do you want to win?
Padres.
I was going to say that because I love the Ha-Seong Kim thing that I sent y'all where he is. Manny Machado, I've always been a fan of his. I don't know. He's got like this quiet confidence that I really, and the fact that he's just willing to show. Don't get me wrong.
Sorry, did you say Manny Machado had quiet confidence?
Yes. It's always, listen, let me explain. I guess I should explain. I fear the fact, obviously he gets demonstrative, but in the moment, I really feel, you know, where Juan Soto gets up there and he's just arrogant from the moment he steps in the box.
Yeah.
And he's got the shuffle and he shimmies and bravado 10,000. Manny gets in the box and he's just, I'm just up here doing my thing. Real quiet, cool, comp. Now, after the fact, he's going to let you know. But like when he's in the box and then he plays an amazing third base, I don't think enough people talk about some of the web gems that he's got in his, you know, arsenal. And I don't know. I understand. I identify with him. The vibes, right? Let me get back to that V word that we're big on. But since
we did not talk about the vibes above replacement, y'all. We didn't talk about it.
The VAR.
Oh, I put it. The VAR.
Yeah, I do think, I guess if I had to pick another team, it would be, other than the Phillies, it'll be the Guardians. I don't super think that's going to happen per our previous conversation, but Stephen Vogt, my husband is from Cleveland, like Stephen Kwan, the Naylor brothers. I just want to see all of that click and Jose Ramirez to be a World Series champion. And they haven't won in freaking forever. So I'll go with them as far as the story goes. But yeah, vibes above replacement. If vibes are leading the charge here, which team, just solely based on vibes, should win the World Series?
Baltimore.
I don't think it is. I think I got to give it to the Mets. I got to give it to the Mets. Between Grimace and how many times do you see a middle-aged baseball player say, you know what, I'm gonna just take a little break and record a hit Latin pop song. And then that become the rallying cry of the fucking team. And the Grimace seat in Citi Field, everyone's all, oh my God, why would you do it? I love that. I fucking love it.
Me too.
Everyone's, oh, it's so hokey. You're talking about it, aren't you? You know what we're talking about. You're talking about the Mets, right? It's fun. Yeah, I don't understand why everyone's so against fun.
I agree.
Because I think they're getting knocked out.
Solely based on vibes. We're not talking about pitching rotations or lineup 1 through 9. Solely on vibes.
This is interesting because I'm going to go with, we're all picking a different vibes above replacement team. I'm going with the Royals because I think, first of all, they have Will Smith, who is just, the writing is on the wall, right? We've all known it from the beginning. But Salvi Perez back in the playoffs at this point in his career, let's freaking go, man. There is nothing I want to see more than Salvi in the World Series again. Bobby Witt Jr. getting to play on that stage when he has had the season that he's had and he's not going to get an MVP. Let's make him a World Series MVP. Why don't we? And then on top of that, they've got, if Tommy fans back can get hot in front of Bobby Witt, let's do it. And that's like the little vibes nucleus of the Royals there.
If we're just picking any team, I picked like a legit, I thought, would actually win.
No, you had vibes. Like, you're, yeah, like, that's not a bad vibes about replacement pick. By any,
but if we're picking any team for vibes, I'm going with the Tigers.
Okay. Okay.
Like, that team went from, hey, we're sellers at the deadline. Let's send our best pitcher out. We're out of it. Okay. Our high-priced star shortstop is trash. Let's get him out of there. And then they just got white-hot. And all the talent. And AJ's pushing all the buttons. And you got Chris Cantalani. I think that's how you say his last name. I can't. Castellani.
Castellani.
Going bananas on Twitter. And just losing his mind. He has been 10 years without a postseason. And now they come from the depths to get in. The Tiger. What is it? The Tiger War or some junk like that in Comerica Park. Like, it's a
We got to get up on that. Oh, that's.
Believe me when I tell you, it's the last team I wanted to see. I fear them the most. They're on such a run. They've got the Cy Young leading the charge.
Yeah, they got nothing to lose. Yep.
And they're
precarious teams.
They have a bunch of young kids that I feel like are just, I don't want to say young and dumb because that sounds bad, but they're just, they're having fun out there. And at this point in time, they're playing with house money, right? So they can play loose and they can just go because who expected them to go this far? And it's now. It's all right. If we don't win, no skin off our backs. We don't have to worry about it. But the fact that they've got Riley Green, they got Parker Meadows playing out of his shoes. Like, Kerry Carpenter has come back and has been awesome for them since he got demoted and then brought back up. And then they got, who is it? Trey Sweeney from that Jack Flaherty trade. And he's come in and been a great shortstop for him. It's one of these things where I'm all, y'all don't know any better. It's fun for you now. And it's literally what I think someone said, that it was the closest to a college clubhouse that they had been in because of all the young guys. I think, who did they say was the oldest? It was one of the pitchers that was the dad or whatever.
In all
and he's 28 or something. Oh yeah. Torque has come back up too. And it's, okay.
They're this year's Diamondbacks to me.
They are.
And I'm terrified.
And that makes me very happy because wasn't Torgelson their number one draft pick a couple of seasons ago? And he just looked like he was not going to pan out. And then here he is doing the things now. And it's that Cinderella story. I hate liking baseball. I hate liking other teams. Damn it. Makes me sad.
It makes it more fun because at least, hey, if take it from me, when you are eliminated, it makes it a lot more fun to still want to be engaged. And right now, it's hard because you have so many teams that you have a vested interest in other than just your own. But at least it'll keep you watching baseball all October long either way.
That's true.
That's with that, I'm going to leave you. But I want you to keep talking about Tommy Edman. And by the time he actually is the World Series MVP, everyone will say they were saying it all along. And it will have started right here with us.
Kelsey, before you leave, real quick, tell the people where they can find you on the interwebs.
Oh, I'm on the Twitter forever at KBirdTweets, KBURD tweets. My weekly podcast, Peace, Love, and Baseball, is on YouTube. It's on wherever you get your podcasts.
And that's where I'm at if I'm not here. Perfect. We love you, Kels. Thanks for hanging out. We'll see you later. Say hi to Mama Bird for us.
I will.
All right. So now that Kelsey has left us, unfortunately, Tom and I are going to wrap it up here in just a little bit. But Tom, who do you think is going to, where is the results going to be? Who are the results going to be? Neither one of those phrases are what I actually wanted to ask. We're going to rewind here. Which teams out of the AL and the NL do you see ending up in the postseason? Who's going to go all the way?
For all the people that are audio only, you have to go see what just happened. Because it's worth it. I promise. Go to YouTube, find Bourbon Baseball, and watch Suzy go forward, realize she fucked up. And look, we're going backwards in time because I'm telling you, it'll be worth your time.
Yeah. So are you going to answer me or are you just going to make fun of me?
To answer? Sorry. I'm trying to get more engagement for the YouTube channel. They need to see that. I promise it'll work. If we're just going series by series, obviously, I do feel that the Astros have enough to beat the Tigers. I'm going to start there. Framber versus Targ School will be must-see TV. I think whichever bullpen...
At 1:30 in the afternoon.
I think whichever bullpen blinks first is obviously going to have the advantage in that game. The Astros are hitting really right now. They're coming off series where Kyle Tucker had, I think it was a 5-for-10 or 5-for-11. Bregman is hot. Tuve is starting to look like that guy. He was trying to get to 300. Yiner had an amazing season, finishing 299. And that's all to say that without Yordan Alvarez, they were able to put runs on the board. The rumors are that Yordan's back in the building, that he could be DHing, which is amazing to hear. So I'd like to say the Astros get that done in two games. We'll see. The Tigers are not to be underestimated. That is a good baseball club led by AJ Hinch, who we all know and love, got the Astros to where they are today. I don't know what they would have been without AJ Hinch. I can say that honestly. I feel that he's a phenomenal manager, and he's going to have them ready. I truly believe these are going to be two or three highly intensive games, and the Astros are going to absolutely have to earn that series. Moving on to the next series, I feel like you really have a Royals team that is probably ahead of schedule. I feel like Baltimore is going to be able to do that. I know you talked about the rotation. I still feel like Baltimore's got enough. Corbin Burns, Cy Young pitcher, and I think they'll figure it out from there. But the other wild card series, obviously, as we sit right now, we don't know how they're going to look because there's still a play-in game or two play-in games to be played. I really feel like Atlanta has the upper hand there. I think they find a way to get that done. And then I don't know what happens if they split. Obviously, the Mets get in, and then they're uber dangerous.
If the Mets or the Braves, if it goes 1-1, D-backs are out, and both the Mets and Braves are in.
Correct. I just don't know who they play. I can't remember how the fifth and sixth were.
I think it would be, let's see here. It would be the fifth seed plays the Padres and the sixth seed plays the Brewers. I was trying to find it. The tiebreaker looks like the Mets. So the biggest tiebreaker to watch is against the Mets, with whom the Braves are tied for the second wildcard spot. The winner of the season series between the two clubs will claim the season series and the head-to-head tiebreaker. The Braves need to win at least one of those two games against the Mets to secure the tiebreaker over New York. So if the Braves win, then they win the tiebreaker. So they will play the Brewers. No, they will play the Padres. And then the Brewers will play the Mets. I think I have that correct. I hope I have that correct. It's a lot of math.
So I really like the Padres. We talked about the Padres. I think that's a really good team. I think whoever they end up getting, they find a way to get by them. The Brewers, I don't know. If there was a top team to not go chalk, like for the thing to not go chalk, I feel like the Brewers are probably the team. And it's no disrespect to them. We just don't see them enough, obviously. I don't see them enough. I know, like we talked about, I know some of the players. Do I think they can go and win a playoff series against some of these teams that are fighting and clawing when they basically were the first team to lock up a division like a month ago? I don't know. I feel like you really hate that sometimes because you need the star steady players to really shine. And when you've got just a bunch of really good guys that aren't great, I don't know if they can just turn it off, turn it on. Though that's the team that scares me as far as the wild card games go.
I think the Brewers, my Mets fans, I love you. I so love you. But when it comes to pitching, it's the Brewers. The Brewers have got, the rotation. I think I trust their rotation over the Mets. And then, I definitely trust their bullpen over the Mets bullpen. I think legitimately any button that Pat Murphy pulls out of that Brewers bag of relievers, I think will outpitch the Mets. So if it's between them, I think it's the Brewers. And I think that's going to shock the world. Now, if it's between the Brewers and Mets, Brewers move on, then they face Philly. Between the Philly and the Brewers, who you got?
Philly, pretty easily. Those guys are A, talented, and B, so veteran-led. They've got so many guys that have been there before. They're basically bringing back the majority of the World Series team that was there. So why wouldn't I feel like they have all the tools? I thought since day one, they were a team in the NL that would probably come out of the thing. They basically got bored towards the end and had nothing to play for. I truly believe that they get up for a postseason. That ballpark is electric. I think the Phillies find a way to get that done fairly short order.
All right. So then between the Braves and the Padres.
That's going to be tough. I feel like the Braves have a lot. They've dealt with a lot, but I think that's part of what makes them so dangerous is because they're playing with house money a little bit. The Padres are a great young story. They weren't supposed to be here, and they're depending on a lot of young talent. So obviously I think they would have the advantage in the rotation just because of what the Braves would have to use to get into that series. They'd be behind where they would want to be as far as like rotation pieces. But they still have Max Fried. They still have Chris Sale. I still think they have enough to win a series. And it'd be fun. I think that one would go like 5 games. I think that one would go a little deeper. And give me the Padres.
Okay. So Padres, Dodgers. Who comes out on top?
My heart wants the Padres to win. My head says the Dodgers will win. It's a big brother, little brother thing. It's like the Orioles-Yankees thing for me. I would love for little brother to beat up big brother because I want to say last year before last, that's how it shook out and the Dodgers just ran through them and was like, nope, you're not there yet. So for me, the Padres getting past the Dodgers would be super cool. I feel like Shohei Ohtani is going to have an electric postseason. And they have enough in there. I say it's weird to say they have enough because their rotation's so bad, but I still feel like the Dodgers have enough bullets to get it done.
Okay. So Dodgers, Phillies. Who comes out on top for right now?
For me, it seems like the Phillies. I really can't see a team beating them in a series, especially a 7-game series. I think their rotation is really good. Like I said earlier, they went out and got some arms for the bullpen during the trade deadline. And that lineup, there's really no holes in it. So give me the Phillies.
All right. So Phillies it is for the NL. So obviously Tigers and Detroit, we obviously know who we think is going to come out on top from there. Houston and Cleveland.
So we just saw this series, sort of. The Astros went into Cleveland with very little to play for. And you spoke very highly throughout the season of the jet stream they got going on. I think the Astros took advantage of it because there were guys hitting bombs that I didn't think could hit bombs, and the ball carried phenomenally well there.
You know what? That wasn't even Zach DiCenzo's ball. Didn't even hit the jet stream. Okay, he just had enough to, I don't know, hit a ball 446 feet to straightaway center field.
That's a bomb. So for me,
in the rain.
Yeah.
I don't know. Anyways, keep going.
But Bregs hit really good. Tuck hit really good. Jason Hayward, who's becoming more and more a part of this lineup and this team, had a couple knocks. So I would love that series for the Astros because I believe that's a really good spot for them with all the other teams that would be left. I totally feel like they would be the favorites in that series. And I think they could get it done in maybe 6 games. I don't want to say that Cleveland can't go win a couple games.
Isn't that a 5-game series though?
Okay, then I'm sorry. Then give me 4 games then. Maybe
okay. I was like, wait, hold on. I think it's 5 because it's 7, right?
ALCS in the World Series.
Yeah, I think it's okay. Astros come out on top of Cleveland and Astros. So between KC and the Orioles, you said Orioles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and now Orioles and the Yanks.
This is the series that I think will be 5 games. It'll come down to the last game. And unfortunately, it'll be in Yankee Stadium. And I think that'll be the difference. Yankee Stadium is an incredibly tough place to play. I feel like the Yankees get it done in 5. It takes everything, a clutch hit, the 7th, 8th inning, something like that. And then their closer puts traffic on the bases but finds a way to get it done. The Yankees survive.
All right. Astros and Yankees.
The series everyone wants to see. The old evil empire versus the new evil empire. Obviously, that would be fantastic. The Astros took some lumps at the beginning of the season against the Yankees. They're going to come in incredibly cocky, incredibly confident. And then the Short King is going to roll into Yankee Stadium and do what the Short King does. So it would be an electric series. I think it would go probably 6 games, but give me Houston. I just feel like right now they're the most complete team in the AL. When you look at offense, provided Yordan's there, all of this is, all I'm saying, every last bit of this with Yordan Alvarez in this lineup. If Yordan Alvarez is not in this lineup, totally changes everything. That's how important he is. But I feel like they have the rotation, they have the bullpen, and they have the lineup to be able to get all the way to the World Series.
Side note, Ben Verlander agrees with us about the day games and Astros. His tweet, just because the Astros have been to the postseason for almost a decade straight doesn't mean they need to continually get screwed with day games. Got the juggernaut of the decade against the hottest team in baseball that shocked the world, and they get all day games? Come on now.
He's right. He's 100%. I mean, I get it. It's in Houston, right? So you can argue it's a central time zone. You know, what are the fans going to watch? And to that, I say it's bullshit. Because I guarantee you that game or those 3 games are going to be more highly contested and more fun to watch as a casual fan than potentially, I want to say the NL game got the late game, right?
I believe so.
Yeah. So you're telling me you want to see a Milwaukee Brewers Mets series more than you want to see an Astros Tigers series? I don't believe
it. So game one, Arizona/Mets versus Brewers at 4:32 Central. And then it would be either Atlanta or Mets versus San Diego at 5:38. Hold on. What is that? What is sight time? Oh, because that's okay. So yeah, first pitch is the night game. So yeah. So it would be either San Diego or San Diego versus Braves or Mets that for the night game on Tuesday. And then, and that's West Coast. I guess it makes sense a little bit, but still, why wouldn't we get the second time, the 4:38 time? What would crack me up is if Guardians fans and Royals fans turn off your ears. I'm very sorry. I feel like MLB would hate all of their lives if somehow managed to be like the Guardians versus the Royals for the ALCS.
Oh, yeah. They're definitely not selling that to anyone. Like, that's the one going, we missed out on how many markets and this is what we're selling? We got to sell Kansas and Ohio?
It would have a little bit of a draw. Bobby Wood Jr., like J-Ram, it would have a little bit, but it wouldn't have the juice of, say, the Yankees, Astros, or like, it's just...
Let's talk pitching matchups. In game one of the ALCS, we've got Cole Reagans versus... I don't even fucking know.
Ben Lively. Ben Lively.
That's...
Oh.
In Ben Lively's last start, he gave up 7 earned runs.
Ay, ay, ay. That would be great. Or is it Gavin? Is it Gavin Williams? I think that was one of their... But see, Guardians have done wonderfully as well because their rotation has been pieced together with, like, duct tape and broken dreams. But none of the teams really are 1,000% top to bottom complete where you don't see any holes. I was going to say, except for maybe the Phillies. Maybe.
Phillies are deep. Wagon.
Yeah. Because Astros, we got some holes. Not going to lie.
Jake Myers.
I mean, no. Jake Myers. Chaz, I need you to come back. I need you to be swinging the bat as well as you had been swinging it when you came back from your jettison to AAA. I need that.
The problem, though. Can you trust Joe Espada to start Chaz McCormick over Jake Myers?
No. And it's not, I don't think it's a trust thing. I think it's a you've been hurt kind of deal. I need the Astros to go get me a center fielder in the offseason. They're not.
Why
not? Gonna, but.
If you're not going to, then bring me Melton. The same way the Padres brought up Jackson. Now, I'm not comparing the two. I'm not saying they're in the same stratosphere. But just do it.
I don't know. I think, let me take that back. I think it all depends on what happens in the postseason. I think the results of the postseason will determine how the offseason plays. I think. But that's for another episode. That's for a Astros edition of Bourbon and Baseball. All right, folks. We are going to wrap it up. If your team did not perform to expectations, Mariners, we're looking at you. Texas Rangers, the fuck have you been doing? You bring shame. You bring shame to the Texas name, okay? I'm going to just say it. We're going to put it out there. And don't give me any bullshit about, our rotation is hurt, blah, blah, blah. Do I need to remind you what the fuck happened to the Astros rotation? No.
Not every team has the studs in the minor leagues or willing to use them. I think they should have backed Kumar Rocker up a lot sooner. I think they should have leaned into their young pitching talent. And I think their problem is not what they spent the money on. It's how they managed.
So if you're a Rangers fan, let us know in the comments about what you think went wrong and how you think things can be fixed in the offseason. Mariner fans, we all know what happened with you guys. I'm so sorry. Mariners fans, I really do apologize because that you as a fan base and that starting rotation deserved better than what happened. And I don't even know. I can't even brainstorm on how to fix that. I don't.
Trade some of that rotation for sticks.
There will be many discussions in the offseason about how we can fix all of the teams. Just Minnesota Twins, I don't know what the fuck happened to you either. Like, you fell off a cliff. You fell off a cliff, I think is what happened. Angels, A's, Oakland, we're gonna talk about you in the offseason as well. My heart broke watching that last home game, seeing the fan base just heartbroken that they no longer have a team in the city that they live in. That is heart-wrenching. Gut-wrenching. Heart-wrenching? I just made up a new word. Gut-wrenching. But I, again, being a newer baseball fan, was not aware of how much history the Oakland Coliseum held. Really and truly, I guess it started with Moneyball. In my head, I know it went back farther, but in my head, Moneyball and on. But to see all of the great pitchers that I wasn't aware of who they were. Raleigh Fingers, Catfish Hunter, looking at you. Very sorry. Baseball fans are cussing my name now.
You didn't even have to go that far back. But yeah, they had some greats.
They did. But we're going to talk about you, and we're going to talk about the modern day Bash Brothers of you guys, because you guys exceeded some expectations this season. And we will talk about you guys in the offseason about your plans going forward. Chicago White Sox, are there words? I don't think there are words. Besides, we're sorry. And I don't think anything is going to change, because Jerry Reinsdorf is still going to be there.
Did you see the letter the owner put out to the fans?
Fucking eyewash. Just so many dumb words. I don't even know why you bothered. I don't know why you bothered, because nothing is going to change. So, I don't know. Cardinals fans, I know, are mad. Sorry, Cardinals fans. I wanted to ask Kelsey before she jumped off, what was the announcements that were being made? Because apparently there's going to be an overhaul of, I don't know, teams and development people and front office people, or I don't know, something. So if you're a Cardinals fan and you're listening, drop it in the comments. I would love to know so that I don't have to bug Kelsey and be like, Kelsey, tell me all the things about the Cardinals. Cubbies. What happened, Cubbies? You got Craig Council. I guess that's what happens when you spend all your money on a manager instead of players. I don't know. But you have Pete Crow Armstrong. He looked really good. Michael Bush also. So I don't know. You got any other teams that you want to apologize to?
Boston. What happened there? You were like the team of destiny, the Netflix special, all the things. And then the last month of the season just fell apart.
Oh. What is that Netflix documentary going to look like?
I don't know.
I
don't know. It's going to be interesting. The Blue Jays. What the fuck are y'all doing? There's a ton of talent on that team, and they're really bad. Tampa. Just like every other year for y'all, y'all going to be great next year because
Tampa's going to be a wagon next year. Tampa's going to be a wagon next year.
What is Washington doing with CJ Abrams? What's going on there? Washington looked like they had a little something cooking, and now it looks like they took a couple steps back. Really interested to see what happens there. Pittsburgh is going to be such an interesting story going into the offseason. They've got so much talent. I feel like Skeens is Cy Young favorite, probably out the door starting the season next year. And he's not the only really good pitcher they have on their team. So
Jared Jones, I think, is going to season a little bit. I don't know. Maybe he's going to come back with a new pitch, hanging out with Paul Skeens in the offseason. Who knows? They also have Bubba Chandler coming up. And Bubba Chandler may be better than Jared Jones.
That's a really good
I'm sorry, Jared Jones. I love you. I love you so much. But I think maybe Bubba Chandler may be better. God, so sorry. And they still have Mitch Keller over there. I feel like if they just got a couple of more sticks, just, I don't know, and maybe try not to be a classless organization that DFAs players or at-bats before they hit a bonus level. Just
so you hinted at that at the beginning of the show. Are you upset that they did not pay him $200,000 just for the sake of paying him?
I think it's the fact that it was 4 at-bats with 6 games left to go. If you knew that you weren't going to reach that level, that bonus, if that decision was already made, then DFA him earlier so that maybe he can get signed with another team. He had been swinging it a lot better after All-Star break. It seemed really shitty.
I get that. I've never been a huge Roddy Tellez fan. I think if you didn't know about the 4 at-bats for the $200,000, you're probably going, oh, they DFA'd Robbie Tellez, no big deal. But it's the four ABs to get to 200K, and it's like,
if that was an extra, level of ick for me personally. But my first upsetness, anger towards the situation was the fact that they did it with six games left to go. Why? That makes no sense. If you were gonna do that, what the fuck?
So the way I look at it, if Rowdy Tellez is playing well, then he's not getting DFA'd. The fact that they saved 200K by getting out from under him to give to someone else or to put into their minor league system, that for me, that makes baseball sense. If you told me if we DFA'd Jake Meyers before the playoffs to save 200K, I'd do it. And why not? He's played for your team the whole year. Yeah, but he wasn't good. So is Rowdy Tellez a long-term Pirate? No. So why pay him an extra 200K just for the sake of doing it? It was the equivalent of going, you know what? I'm not going to watch Netflix because they're going to raise my rates next month. So I'm going to cancel it before they do that.
That's fair. But if I trusted the organization to that 200K that they, quote unquote, saved from not paying Rowdy Tellez to put back into the organization or to try and pay somebody else, I would maybe see it and be like, okay. But the fact that their track record kind of speaks for itself, that they haven't done that. Cincinnati Reds, looking at you too. So it's one of those things where I don't feel bad for billionaires with a B. Obviously, you got there somehow, and maybe it's not frittering away $200,000 or whatever. But the fact that you could fritter away $200,000 and that would be like me finding a penny on the fucking ground. I don't think Rowdy Tellez has oodles and oodles of money. So that 200K could have been a house.
Do I think Rowdy Tellez is a millionaire, though? I do. So I don't feel bad for millionaires with an M, because I am not. So the fact that he didn't make 200K, for me, doesn't bother me near as much as I've seen. And it's not just you. I've seen a lot of people really upset about the fact that they didn't do the good guy thing and make sure he got his bonus. And as a sports fan of other sports, this happens all the time. People are like trying to get, or teams are trying to get out of paying roster bonuses and incentives because the person underperforms. So it's not a big deal to me, but I understand you're upset.
Yeah, you're right. But it's one of those where I guess at this point in time, it is a business and that's how you run a fucking business. And again, this is why I'm a quote unquote small business and not bigger than I am.
Because see, there's other sides to it too. Perfect example. And I know this is going to irk you a little bit, but I invite you to go look it up. Big John Singleton, when he came up with the Astros, he got signed to a contract right off rip. They tried to get out in front of it.
Never
lived up to that contract. And it was like the Astros trying to go, look, we want to take care of you up front because we think you can be really good for this team. And he just never performed. So on the inverse side of it, putting in a roster bonus and then going, look, we're not going to pay you because you weren't very good. The Pirates protected themselves in that manner where the Astros kind of just went on blind faith and said, Big John, here you go. And he never got there. Now, fast forward 10 years later, the guy's obviously a big part of what the Astros are doing right now. And I just got done saying he could be an unsung hero in this postseason.
Let's hope. So again, we will talk about all of the teams in the offseason. But we will be obviously a little bit more focused on the postseason. I haven't quite figured out our recording schedule for postseason. We will talk amongst ourselves and let y'all know as soon as we know. But just know that there will be other episodes coming out talking about Astros versus whomever. And we will discuss the NL side, all of the AL. We will do it. We just don't know when. But with that, we're going to wrap it up. Tom, final thoughts?
Can't wait. Looking forward to the Astros making another deep postseason run. Hopefully with a parade at the end. That'd be pretty cool to talk about.
Fingers crossed. Where can they find you on the interwebs?
On Twitter, at Third Coast Tom. That's where I do the most of my shenanigans. I'm trying to be a little bit better about using Instagram for more than just scrolling. You can find me there at TCTom1. Another place that you may find both of us at some point, if we do have the ability to do so, is the PSF app. We have been pretty good about, and if there's an opportunity to do a postseason game, I'm sure we will. It's a great place to be if you can't be in a ballpark or don't want to spend hundreds and hundreds of dollars to go to a postseason game. We're a place where on the PSF app where you can go with like-minded fans and just vent, scream, cry, yell, whatever, with people that are doing the same thing. I'd like to think we're a pretty good time on this podcast. We're definitely a good time on the PSF app. So if you're looking for that, if you see us on the socials posting that up, whether it be Instagram or Twitter, come check us out on the PSF app.
For sure. If you have not already, given us a 5-star rating or written out a nice review, please do that. We would love that forever. Hit like on this episode. Hit subscribe on the YouTubes. We would love that. I think we have reached 250 subscribers on the YouTubes. Hooray, all of you. We appreciate you guys. And with that, we are going to say...
You did not say yay baseball.
I did not say yay baseball. I muted my mic on accident. Actually, I take that back, though, because I did not show off the shirt. So this is why. I muted my mic on purpose to keep it going. Shout out Ram Shirts. Houston is what? Inevitable, folks. Inevitable. Shout out to Margo over at Ram Shirts. Go get you some gear. All right. He's having a sale as well. We don't have a code because guess what? Everything's on sale. Not everything, but like most things are on sale. He also is a small business and he's a great guy, but he's got some fun other designs as well. 90% of the other Astros gear I wear on all of the shows, probably from Ram Shirts or Apollo. I show you mostly from Ram Shirts though. Go over there. Get you some shirts, get you some swag. And now we are going to say baseball and record, maybe.